Okay, thank you. You are all expert in this, so I won't belabor too much of this, but I want to set a little bit of context for some of our work. This is the status quo in most global health and global development programs. Money comes in from the World Bank, from USAID, from the Gates Foundation, all the way down to Rotary Clubs and Family Foundations, and they often have a technology component. Things like water filters, cook stoves, latrines, boreholes are installed and are intended to have an impact on people's health and livelihood. But in many cases, that impact is only measured for a very short period of time. With the funding cycles that are available through most of these interventions, and that's including a lot of the infrastructure work that governments will do, you have very short funding windows, and under the best of circumstances, you may be able to hire Berkeley or Stanford, sometimes less often Portland State, to run a randomized controlled trial. And you might be looking at health outcomes or economic outcomes. But even with that highest quality data, it's a snapshot in time. And the RCT published in 2016 about something in 2014 doesn't tell you much about what's happening next year. And as a result, the sustained impact of many of these interventions is not there. About half of the water and sanitation interventions that are funded and implemented every year are broken within 18 months and in many cases never get fixed. Some estimates suggest that as much as 75% of the gains under MDG 7, access to clean drinking water, are fiction, are people that had infrastructure that is now broken or have access to infrastructure that's contaminated. So there's a measurement issue here, but there's also an incentive issue. There are issues with how we align sustained impact with the funding. So our team has trialed a number of different approaches. I'll speak mostly about our technology approaches for this audience, but we also think about the business question, the incentives in global health and development programs through trying to align funding, pay by performance, pay for results, things like carbon credits, health credits, other ways to monetize and incentivize long-term sustained impact and get it away from the finite grant-funded approach. And the other piece is instrumentation, IoT, Internet of Things-based satellite and cellular-based sensors that we can install on household interventions, community interventions, and infrastructure, both as a measurement tool, but also as an intervention. The sensors themselves and the data that is acted upon is itself an intervention. So I'll give a few examples of where we've applied this in a number of countries. This is Rwanda. We've already heard other people in the room are working in Rwanda. We run a nationwide program in Rwanda delivering household water filters and improved cook stoves to the poorest quarter of households. It's run as a public health intervention through the Ministry of Health using private finance. It's private money through a social enterprise based in the UK called Delagoa Health. And to date, we've reached about 1.5 million people in the western province of Rwanda. We have about 500,000 people across 100,000 households with a stove and a water filter. And in the eastern province, about 200,000 more households that have a stove this year. And this is an ongoing program. In yellow, we have our control sectors for our health impact RCT, where we're powered to look at water quality, air quality, use, exposure, pneumonia and diarrhea, and also clinical outcomes for pneumonia and diarrhea among children under five. So it's one of the largest environmental health RCTs that's been run. And we're able to use a big piece of that RCT is knowing what the compliance measures are, trying to get away from surveys and observations that have been typically used by epidemiologists and health economists as a measure of compliance and have much more direct measures of actual behavior. This is the stove. It's a high-efficiency cook stove. And the water filter is the Lifestraw Family 2.0. We operationalize this through the Community Health Worker Program. We have about 1,000 community health workers that work for us pretty much full time. It's a rotating cast across the country. And they're delivering the products in households, and they're also delivering behavior change messaging. We visit every single household about every 9 months to reinforce behavior and to monitor that behavior. And all of our community health workers have a smartphone. This is kind of old school at this point, but they all have a smartphone. They're recording data on barcodes of the stoves and filters, GPS coordinates. People are signing contracts with us, and that all goes into our real-time database for monitoring the program performance. But one of the key indicators, as I mentioned a moment ago, is actually measuring use. We've been able to show through our instrumentation in a variety of contexts now that surveys and observations are very poor indicators of actual behavior. Even the best available tools, the WHO has a whole booklet on how to do surveys for household water filters, like that's a thing. And even under those, using those best available tools, there's poor agreement between surveys, observations, and measured behavior using instrumentation. And we've also shown this in other applications like cook stoves and latrines. In this particular case, we had a RCT last year where we hid sensors. In fact, it was that nested study was funded by Dill out of Berkeley. We hid sensors inside the stoves and water filters, and in half of the households, we showed them the sensor, and then the other half, they didn't know it was there. And we were able to compare three things: surveys, and behavior when people know that the sensor's in their filter and stove, and behavior when they don't know the sensor is there. And here's what we saw. People typically tell us, using those best available survey tools, that they use about a liter and a half per person per day, which is exactly what we tell them to do, too. And it exactly matches up to household size and the size of the water filter. It's great data. It's great results. It's not great data. When people know the sensor's there, they're only using about a liter of water per day, per person per day. And when they don't know the sensor's there, which is our best available data of actual behavior, they're using about half a liter a day. So there's a huge discrepancy between surveys and then the actual reactivity that sensors themselves impose. And this behavior persists for more than 4 weeks. Each of these groupings are one weekly round of data. In the open arm, people know the sensor's there is in blue, and they don't know it's there in red. And we see between a 50 and 100% increase in use that persists for a month with the water filters. So we know that we need to get better in how we measure, but we also know that instrumentation themselves can be an intervention and can be reactive. When we combine the use data with exposure data, with health outcome data, we can model health impacts. And this is a piece of what our team's working on now, is how do we bridge that gap between the expensive, really high quality RCTs and the cheap, pretty low quality M&E that we often do at scale? What are the indicators that can be predictive of health impact without having to do an RCT every time? So when we look at a 46% reduction in diarrhea, 28% reduction in indoor air pollution, we can model that through a couple of best available science that aggregates a number of RCTs to estimate morbidity and mortality on an ongoing basis. In particular, that we estimate this program through the combined intervention of stoves and filters saves 2,500 disability-adjusted life years every year. This is a piece that we're trying to monetize now and align with payment, performance-based payments. And here's how it would work. When we install things like stoves and filters or latrines or other health interventions, we can use instrumentation, we can use water quality, air quality monitoring tools to estimate exposure and adoption. That data can be modeled into health impact data and adoption data and turned into monetizable commodities. In this case, carbon credits, we're doing that now. We are generating, earning, and selling carbon credits under the United Nations that are tied to reduce fuel use. And we're also working towards earning health credits from both stoves and filters that we would sell, ideally, to the World Bank. And it's a hybrid of a business approach, and the source of funding would still come from some of the traditional foreign aid agencies. But you're paying for the outcome and the impact rather than the promise up front. And that money would then be reinvested on an ongoing basis into programs to sustain that impact, rather than spending $20 million putting out 300,000 stoves and walking away a couple years later. That's one example of where we've used our instrumentation. Here's another example. This is a broken water pump. You guys have seen these before. You can go to a village in Rwanda or in Kenya or Uganda, and you'll see three water pumps, and one says World Bank, and one says CRS, and one says USAID, and two of them are broken, one's about to break. We incentivize coverage. We incentivize more infrastructure. How many new people are covered this year? How much are our costs this year of our capital costs divided by how many new people are provided with a service this year? If we bought a new car every time we had a flat tire, it would be a very expensive way to have transportation. And yet that is the paradigm for the vast majority of these types of interventions. We do not enable implementers or governments to care and sustain ongoing services. So we put sensors on hand pumps a couple years ago in Rwanda. We had funding from UK DFID, put them on 200 hand pumps in three different groups. Business as usual model, where they were maintained basically when the implementer could get around to it. What's called a circuit rider model, where there were dedicated staff whose jobs it were full time, it was to go around to different water pumps and maintain them. And then what we call the ambulance model, where the sensor data itself was used by the implementer to respond to and go out and maintain a pump. So we had sensor data in all three groups, but only in a third of them was the data available during the trial period. And we saw a pretty dramatic impact on functionality. In the baseline, when a pump broke, it was broken for on average 200 days. And the average functionality was about 56%, which is typical. There's been some large meta studies of rural water infrastructure, and it's about half in many of these countries. In the circuit rider model, we were able to drop that to 60 days of mean service interval and about a 70% functionality, but only in the ambulance model, where the sensor data was actively used, were we able to get above 90% functionality. And guess what? That's cheaper. It's cheaper to fix things than it is to go install new things all the time. Should be obvious, it's not what's done in this field, mostly. What we're trying to do now is drop that to zero. We talked a little bit about machine learning earlier in the day. We're doing the same thing. We're trying to figure out what the tire pressure warning light is for a broken hand pump or a borehole using machine learning algorithms. We have some support from the National Science Foundation, where we're aggregating all of our data from our water pumps and looking at what features are predictive of a pump that's about to break. And in this particular case, we see nominal pump function, and then we get to see about 6 days of off nominal behavior for this pump before it actually breaks. And that's the key window where we want to dispatch technicians to have zero downtime. I'll give a couple other examples really quickly. We've used sensors in latrines, a few thousand latrines now in India and Bangladesh and Kenya over the past few years. And this is one particular study, but in all cases, it kind of looks the same. There's a dramatic discrepancy between surveys and observations as a category of measure and sensor-derived estimates of use of latrine interventions, which is critical because if everybody's telling you they're using the latrine and you don't see a health impact, it implicates the technology or the intervention and not necessarily the behavior or the measure. We've also done this with social enterprises, with Sanergy Inc. I'm sure many of you know them in Nairobi. We have our sensors in their latrines now monitoring use. Our sensors trigger waste collectors to come out and service the latrines. And we also have franchisees scanning RFID badges so that they can come out and request a visit. And so we're trying to optimize Sanergy's response as a business. And then what's next? We're taking some of this to scale now in two very large programs, one in Ethiopia, one in Kenya, both funded by USAID. And they're the first time that USAID has ever funded rehabilitation of water services and required service delivery as an indicator of the performance of the grant. So we're putting satellite based, this is the Iridium networks instead of cellular. Everything else I talked to you so far about is our cellular based sensors. These are satellite based sensors that we're putting in these electrically powered boreholes in very remote regions in Ethiopia and Kenya. And in all cases, they're monitoring functionality, performance, identifying service issues, and enabling the cognizant government authorities to go out and maintain these boreholes. And we're already seeing some pretty big impact. There's a huge what's called non-revenue water gap where the boreholes are often not working. They're supposed to be billing for them, but they're not billing enough, and people aren't getting water. So there's the triage is not really happening. With our instrumentation, we can identify how much water is being extracted and who should be billed for it, and hold accountable either the small to medium size enterprises or the government actors that are supposed to be providing this infrastructure. That's both in Ethiopia and in Kenya. And these are the decision response aids that we provide. So this is available online, on your phone. It's available through the funders, from the funders all the way down to the technicians who can see when a pump is functioning, how much water is being extracted, and most critically, for how long a pump has not been working. You've seen pictures like this throughout my presentation and other presentations today, and they are used in annual reports of all of our organizations and academic units, and they're on our walls. This picture is not evidence of anything, and yet it's used as evidence. This type of information is used as evidence of impact everywhere. This picture tells us that the day this picture was taken, these kids had clean water. And by the way, it's a five-year-old picture. We have to replace pictures, we have to replace anecdotes with continuous performance measures and align those performance measures with the financial incentives of all of these institutions. And so that's a bit of what we're doing. Thank you.